I'm Joaquim Ferreira, I'm a neurologist. I'm based at the University of Lisbon. I work in the field of Parkinson's disease for the past 20 years, and I'm here to discuss with you what's the best strategy in terms of the approach when we see a patient for the first time with early signs of Parkinson's disease. This is a very pragmatic decision because it's made by all physicians, all neurologists see a patient for which they assume that they have a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, and then they need to make a very practical decision. Should I start treating the patient with the medicines that we have available from now? Or, and again, if that decision is assumed, again, what's the best medicine to start, you know, using and prescribing in that patient? Unfortunately, till now, we don't have what we are looking for, that is a medicine that it's able or to prevent or ideally to cure the disease from, you know, manifesting, you know, their features. So we are limited to a portfolio of medicines that they only do is improve the symptoms, you know, the clinical features, the signs and the symptoms presented by the patient. So responding to the very pragmatic question, if I'm obliged to start treatment from, you know, the first moment that I make a diagnosis, you know, the true answer is no, it's not mandatory. We can support to delay that decision because, unfortunately, we are not able to delay those symptoms from progressing. Again, I will be back later to this decision because there are other arguments that may in some way make, you know, to balance this decision. But coming back to what are the best medicine, if we assume that we should start treatment patients at that moment, the following question is, what's the best medicine, what's the best treatment, you know, to do that approach? So regarding the different options that we have, you know, to support our decision, if we decide to start prescribing a medicine, again, from the list of medicines available, we can choose levodopa. That clearly has an indisputable symptomatic effect. We can start with the dopamine agonists, and we have different dopamine agonists available. We have even different formulations of dopamine agonists available, you know, immediate release, slow release. We have MAO-B inhibitors, and then we have different MAO-B inhibitors available, and we even have other drugs like anticholinergics, amantadine available, that clearly are in the list of options that we should in some way discuss. You know, the decision that we will make should be based on the best information available, and clinical trials are critical to support that decision. And clearly, after the year 2000, again, we had access to many clinical trials comparing, for instance, levodopa with dopamine agonists. And we have learned several things that clearly should be the basis for our decision. One of the things that we have learned is that dopamine agonists are potent anti-Parkinsonian medicines, and it is possible to keep patients on single monotherapy with dopamine agonists for 5 years. So clearly, are dopamine agonists efficacious anti-Parkinsonian drugs? Yes, and they are clearly in the list of the drugs that we can choose. Are MAO-B inhibitors also anti-Parkinsonian drugs that have a clear symptomatic effect? Yes, and this applies to rosagiline, this applies to selegiline, and more recently to isafinamide, even if the level of evidence and the quality of the data that supports each other is slightly different. But when we analyze those comparative trials that have compared levodopa with dopamine agonists, for instance, one of the things that we have learned is that levodopa is clearly better in symptomatic terms. Even in prospective, randomized, blind studies, where physicians were able, in a blind way, to add an extra medication if they felt that patients were not well treated, those who were, from the beginning, in the levodopa arm played always better in motor terms. So this is in line with something that we know for almost 50 years, that is, levodopa is clearly, you know, the best drug in symptomatic terms, and it's also the best tolerated, and that play better in terms of safety. So coming back to the decision that we need to make at that early stage, again, if we decide to start treatment, you know, regarding those different options, what we can say is all options are legitimated by the data that we have accessible. The decision should be made a little bit on the characteristics of the patients and on the goals that we define for each patient. For instance, if we have a patient that has a very active, you know, profession, that is exposed, that should be optimized in terms of motor terms, in terms of what is asked to be his daily life, clearly levodopa, it's the most potent one. On the other hand, if we have patients for which being optimized in symptomatic terms, it's not as demanding. So it's not, they don't have the type of activity where being optimized in motor terms is so critical. Clearly, other medicines, you know, being a dopamine agonist or a MAO-B inhibitor may be clearly adequate and may be a good option. So another factor that clearly is in the mind of physicians when they need to make this decision, it's the age of the patient. And this is mainly because of the fear to induce and develop dyskinesia and motor fluctuations. So is there any reason, you know, to be more specific in terms of decision when we have a younger patient that we need to make that decision to start treatment? Yes, because what we have learned from those dopamine agonists versus levodopa trials is that clearly by starting with the dopamine agonists, we delay the occurrence, the first occurrence of motor fluctuation and dyskinesia. And in those patients, this may be a factor to support that decision being going early for a dopamine agonist. Clearly, we will discuss later if that decision at that early stage means the first 5 years after the first prescription, have implications later. This means after 5 years, after 10 years, after 15 years. And in some way, I can anticipate that that protective factor regarding the really troublesome motor fluctuation and dyskinesia disappears after the onset of levodopa. So after in the first 5 years, clearly that benefit is there. But unfortunately, what we are preventing, it's the onset of dyskinesia and motor fluctuation that are not troublesome, at least at that moment. And later, when it really counts, the question and the implications are clearly different. So in summary, regarding this very important question, that is how and when to start treatment with an anti-Parkinsonian medication. And starting by the when, unfortunately, we don't have the medicine that we are looking for. That means that we have something that delays disease from progressing or ideally cures the disease. So we need to decide if it's mandatory to start immediately or to postpone when the symptoms may be slightly more severe. So it's, again, clearly not being mandatory, I have to say that there is a growing level of evidence supporting that better symptomatic treatment at an early stage may have a long-term benefit. And this is the case, then we need to discuss what's the drug available that guarantees that better symptomatic treatment at an early stage. And again, I have touched already in that comparison between levodopa, dopamine agonists, and MAO-B inhibitors, and clearly levodopa. It's from all the drugs available, the one that has a better symptomatic effect, the one that generates a better perception of benefit for the patients, and at the same time, it's the better tolerated and the most safe that we have available. Regarding the how, and in some way I'm already responding, from those three options, we know that levodopa clearly it's symptomatic, highly efficacious. Dopamine agonists also are good anti-Parkinsonian medications like the MAO-B inhibitors. And the decision then should be based on other factors like age. And regarding the age factor, we know that it's possible to keep patients just being treated with dopamine agonists for 5 years with a good symptomatic effect. And this may be the case for some of the younger patients. And also, even if we recognize that the symptomatic effect of MAO-B inhibitors, being selegiline, rasagiline, is not as high as the type of effect that we get with dopamine agonists and levodopa, it's also possible to induce some anti-Parkinsonian effect and keep patients on those medications for some time. So then the option, it's a little bit personalized based on the characteristics, on the goals of the patient that we have in front of us, and clearly there where physicians should be able to make a proper decision knowing the data that it's behind and should support their, you know, prescription at that stage. Regarding one of the most important questions when we discuss Parkinson's disease, that is, do we have any treatment that delays disease from progressing? And the easy answer is no, we don't have. And it's unfortunately, you know, it's difficult to find that cure that we are looking for in Parkinson. But in fact, you know, the best data we have, it's not able still to demonstrate that any medicine, any other treatment delays disease from progress or cures the disease or prevents its occurrence. But the answer merits a little more in-depth discussion. That is, what's the medicines, what are the treatments we have that are more close, you know, to reach that goal that is being able to disease, you know, disease from, you know, aggravating symptoms with time. You know, from the different trials that we have available, I can say that one trial called Adagio, and physicians like to give these names to the trials, you know, that compared Radagiline with placebo in a very complex design, ended up to demonstrate that hypothetically Radagiline could delay a little bit, you know, the progression of the disease. I'm saying hypothetically because the demonstration was not full conclusive, so it's not yet something that it's approved. But again, in some way, it's probably the best data we have close to demonstrate that effect. So for instance, in younger patients, at least patients should know that from the different medicines available, that was the one that at some point there was some conviction, some data supporting slightly that possibility. Then there are other trials that have looked for that effect, for instance with levodopa. There are two very interesting trials. Again, we gave those trials names, so L-DOPA and LEAP, that have compared levodopa with placebo, again in complex designs, and at the end, you know, they were not conclusive that clearly levodopa could delay disease from progressing, but the door is not completely closed. And there are still some details regarding the type of analysis, the type of results that may not close completely that door. There are other trials, for instance, identical with this Adagio, but conducted with other drugs, like including dopamine agonists, like pramipexol, that also tried to evaluate if that effect was there, and the trial was negative. But again, to be a little optimistic, I need to say that the treatments we have available don't include just medicines. For instance, there is also very interesting data that we should look attentively, suggesting that exercise, and mainly aerobic exercise, may at some point also delay disease from progressing. And exercise, it's easy to implement then, you know, a new medicine, because it's just asking the patients to start, you know, doing physical activity themselves. So we should not exclude all this discussion to medicines, and we should enlarge it to other treatments like exercise, as I was mentioned. The other comment that I would like to make, it's a little bit that even if those trials were negative, we always learn something. And what we have been learning is that treating better patients at an early stage, they seem to be better later in time. So for instance, a patient that was treated with one of the medicines that I mentioned, being levodopa, being, you know, other medicine, being Radagiline, it seems that if they improve more at the beginning of a trial, even when we evaluate them later, you know, those who were treated with those drugs that we call symptomatic, so increasing the effect, seem to have some benefit later. So even if I cannot say that this is conclusive data, it suggests that a better improvement, so a better symptomatic effect early, may have long-term benefits. If it is true that treating better patients at an early stage have a long-term benefit, meaning that after 5 years, 10 years, they are better, then in some way we should revise our own strategies. And then when we discuss how and when we should start treating patients when we make a diagnosis for the first time, you know, being a little more demanding and a little more ambitious in terms of what's the best strategy clearly will have implications. Again, this is just an hypothesis, but an hypothesis that has already some support. And on the other hand, there is nothing against, you know, that strategy, because now we know a little better how we should use medicines at the early stage. So there were doubts, and in some way physicians were afraid of some strategies, but clearly the information that we get from clinical trials now prepared all of us much better to use the medicines that we have available in a better way. As I mentioned before, one of the fears that it's in the mind of physicians when they need to make a therapeutic decision for a new patient, it's the risk to induce motor fluctuations, wearing off, on-off fluctuations, and dyskinesia. This may not be something that physicians make explicit, but we know that it's clearly what they fear, because at any moment we want to induce harm. So, and that decision may not have, you know, immediate implications, maybe something that will influence, you know, patient's quality of life later, and this is even more worrisome for physicians. So it's a decision that really should be well supported. And as I mentioned before, again, in the, you know, early this century, all the trials comparing levodopa with dopamine agonists ended up favoring dopamine agonists. And this means that at the end point of those trials, patients that started with dopamine agonists had less motor fluctuations and less dyskinesia. So clearly, first, it's possible to treat patients at an early stage with dopamine agonists in monotherapy, so just with dopamine agonists, without using levodopa, and they stay well, so without any additional need of any other medicine. But the question is it really relevant, you know, what we have achieved with that early use of dopamine agonists? You know, the longest trial, it's a trial that compared ropinirole with levodopa as early treatment. And what we know, as I mentioned, is that patients that were treated first with ropinirole really delayed the onset of dyskinesia and motor fluctuations. But again, this is what we call the early stage for Parkinson's, and this is what we call the honeymoon period. So, in fact, we have delayed dyskinesia, but the dyskinesia and the motor fluctuations that appear for the first 5 years, in general, they are non-troublesome. So they don't generate really discomfort. They may be seen by relatives, but for the patients in general, and of course there are always exceptions, they are not major in terms of generating discomfort. So what we have learned is that it is possible by using dopamine agonists before levodopa to delay the onset of dyskinesia and motor fluctuations. But for those 5 years, the dyskinesia and the motor fluctuations tend to be slight and non-troublesome. So the true question is, what are the implications later when really it is more difficult to treat these patients? And what we know from the follow-up of those patients is, and we followed those patients and we have the data regarding those patients for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, is that almost all after some time will need to be treated also with levodopa. And from then on, the occurrence of dyskinesia start and the occurrence of motor fluctuations, occurs after. At the later stage, when we compare those two strategies, starting with levodopa or dopamine agonists, we end up concluding that once we start levodopa as an added treatment, that protective effect disappears. So after 10 years, after 15 years, you know, the severity of the motor fluctuation and the dyskinesia, it's the same. So we have learned that at an early stage, when in general, you know, that those problems are not as severe, clearly there is a delaying effect by the early use of dopamine agonists, but when really it counts, when really the patients have those problems that are troublesome, in fact, those two strategies are not different in terms of the real benefit. So what's the clinical relevance of delayed onset of dyskinesia? I would say not much for the first 5 years, because later, when they are really troublesome, that effect that clearly we have classified as beneficial is lost. And when patients really, you know, are being disturbed by the severe dyskinesia, it has been the same starting with levodopa or dopamine agonist, and almost all patients at the later stage will need levodopa as an adjuvant treatment. It's important also to state that, again, even in negative trials, we have learned a lot in these past years. You know, there is a trial, again, with an acronym that it's called STRIDE-PD. And this is a trial that has compared two strategies at an early stage of Parkinson's disease. That was starting with levodopa carbidopa, or starting with what it was called a triple combination, so levodopa carbidopa and entacapone. And the idea was that by adding entacapone to one of the arms of that treatment, it would be possible to obtain a more stable effect in terms of the plasma levels of levodopa that would end up delaying the occurrence of dyskinesia. Unfortunately, again, this trial was negative. This means that it was not possible to demonstrate this hypothesis, but we have learned a lot regarding what's the best strategy to use levodopa in clinical practice. For instance, we have learned that clearly the dose factor is important, and we were also able to, in some way, define a threshold. And the threshold, it's around 400 milligrams of levodopa. So what we can tell now to physicians is that when they use doses until around 400 milligrams, they clearly are in the safer side in terms of the risk of inducing dyskinesia and motor fluctuations. And when they use higher doses, that risk increases. So again, we are now much more prepared when we decide to use levodopa in early stage patients, because we know better what's what we may call best practice in terms of the management of levodopa in those patients. So we end up with a very practical question that is, what is being recommended for the treatment of early Parkinson's disease? And again, all physicians have their own strategies. One of the strategies to support our own practice is to go to the guidelines, the therapeutic recommendations available, because in some way there are people doing the critical appraisal of the best data of the literature and in some way supporting our own decisions. And I would clearly recommend that, again, colleagues, you know, everybody that at some point is in the management of Parkinson, you know, to read attentively those recommendations and check the quality of the recommendations that are, you know, key pieces of information in the field of the treatment of Parkinson's disease. And what we know, and again, I'm coming back a little bit to what we have been discussed, you know, during this talk, is that almost all anti-Parkinsonian medicines that we have available induce improved Parkinsonism. Then the question is, what those of medicines clearly have the data supporting its use at an early stage? As I have mentioned, unfortunately, we don't have any medicine that delays disease from progressing. So what we have are different treatments that just induce a symptomatic effect. And then we should start looking to the data from the different pharmacological classes that are available. So one of the medicines that is clearly recommended for the treatment of early PD is levodopa, being levodopa standard release or levodopa slow release. So both improve the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So what we have learned, again, from data from recent clinical trials is that we should be cautious in terms of dose. So ideally, we should avoid using doses that are not needed in terms of symptomatic effect that it's, again, tried for a specific patient. So, and we should stay not above 300 milligrams, 400 milligrams at the starting point. The second pharmacological class for which we have data also supporting its use at an early stage are the dopamine agonists. And we have dopamine agonists, again, with immediate release, slow release, and also at least one dopamine agonist that it's used as a transdermic mode of administration. And the decision should be based in factors that are not just related with the immediate efficacy. So are there any reason to choose a slow release formulation of a dopamine agonist? In terms of global benefit, no, because again, we are talking about the same type of medicine, but we know that the slow release formulations are in some way better tolerated at an early stage. So in some way, we may reach higher doses when we use a slow release formulation compared with an immediate release. But this is really a detail in terms of what we need to know when we need to make a decision regarding immediate release or slow release. The same applies for another, you know, dopamine agonist, that is rotigutin, that is a transdermic form of administration that has specific trials supporting its efficacy. But again, this is a different way of administration for a drug that belongs to the dopamine agonists pharmacological class. There is a safety aspect that we should mention, that is the risk of inducing fibrotic, cardiac or abdominal fibrotic adverse events. And this is associated with the ergolinic dopamine agonist. That's why when we read attentively the recommendations, the ergolinic dopamine agonists in some way are being recommended at the second level and not as first option due to this safety profile that clearly, if we have available ergolinic and non-ergolinic, favors the non-ergolinic as the first option when we decide to use dopamine agonist for the treatment of early PD. Then we have the MAO-B inhibitors. And from the MAO-B inhibitors, the only two that are being recommended and there are best data supporting its use at an early stage, it's selegiline and rasagiline. And again, they entered the market at different moments. So clearly the quality of the trials is better for rasagiline, and in some way, the data that we have supporting its use at an early stage may be slightly better for rasagiline, but clearly we need to know a little bit, you know, the period and the trials and the logic behind the studies that they have demonstrated the effect, and clearly this should be taken in consideration when we make a decision regarding treatment and regarding the options for these type of patients. It's also important to know that some older drugs like anticholinergics, amantadine. Again, the best data available, you know, from case reports, from smaller studies, also suggest that they may have an anti-Parkinsonian effect, but we don't have the trials and the trials with quality that ended up, you know, supporting them and putting them as first medicines in terms of formal guidelines or therapeutic recommendations. But again, there is a need to put everything in context regarding the moment of development, regarding availability, and clearly the decision for a patient that we are following in Portugal, in the UK, in Germany, it's different from a patient that we are following in countries where the portfolio of drugs available, it's clearly not the same that we are, you know, we have the privilege to have in the Western countries. One of the common criticisms to clinical trials is that they don't really mimetize what is happening in real world. This means that we are testing one drug versus placebo or versus another drug, and in real terms, our patients are being treated with several drugs. On the other hand, the type of care that the patient has when he is in a clinical trial, it's different from the type of care and is being followed by a GP or a neurologist in routine. So it's interesting also to look to data from very pragmatic trials, and there is a recent very pragmatic trial that has been done in Parkinson's disease. It has a long duration, 7 years, and that has compared two strategies. Starting patients with levodopa immediately when the diagnosis is made, or what it has been called the sparing strategy for levodopa, and patients were treated with dopamine agonists or MAO-B inhibitors, being selegiline or vasagiline. So patients that were treated from the beginning with levodopa were slightly better in a persistent small effect, but again, an effect that clearly is clear in functional terms using, an item from a quality of life scale. In that trial, the patients that were treated from the beginning with levodopa after 7 years were, again, presented a small but persistent benefit in a functional outcome. And functional outcome means in parameters that in some way relate with what we do in our, you know, normal days. So in some way this supports the idea that clearly levodopa, it's the most potent medicine regarding improving our capability to do what we are supposed to do, that's what we call function, compared with starting treatment with dopamine agonists or MAO-B inhibitors. And this effect in these functional parameters in that quality of life scale, it's the closest we can have regarding what we can observe and measure and in some way give relevancy regarding the type of tasks that we are doing in our routines. Another study that has a different design but in some way also supports the potential benefit of treating patients better at an early stage are studies that have evaluated quality of life of patients, for instance, treated with levodopa at an early stage. And what we have learned is really that quality of life responds well to that early decision to treat. So treating patients early, again, may have that long-term benefit, but in the short term, what we know is that it improves quality of life. So if there is nothing against, clearly what we know is, you know, starting treatment at an early stage in the short term clearly induce that benefit that clearly we should add with all other information that I've already shared in terms of what we call symptomatic benefit and what we should bring to the discussion when we are deciding if we should start treatment early and how to start that treatment.